Part 3, Enter the Buffs. Having satisfactorily accounted for the nuttiness of the main lone nutter, the Warren Commission did not shirk its duty to investigate the man who had shot their fox. They had to be a little cautious, however. In March 1964, Jack Ruby was sentenced to death for the murder of Lee Harvey Oswald. By the time the commission came to interview him, he was appealing against his conviction. The Chief Justice of the United States knew better than to prejudice Ruby's right to due legal process. The commission should not say anything more denigratory about him than had come out at his trial, and categorically must not express an opinion as to whether he had committed the crime of murder. Jack Ruby, they found, was a pretty unsuccessful strip club owner. Aged 41 in 1962, he had been born in Chicago, the son of Jewish immigrants called Rubinstein. Wild at school and nicknamed Sparky for his volatile temper, he had been precociously sexually active, also keen to establish his reputation as the toughest kid on the block. Leaving school at 16, he engaged in various low-level street-smart activities, ticket scalping and selling tips on racing form. He worked briefly for Local 20467 of the Scrap Iron and Junk Handlers Union, resigning after the union president shot Ruby's personal friend, the local's financial secretary, in a quarrel. But this was apparently before the union's infiltration by criminal elements. His war service in the U.S. Air Force had been home-based, marked by little more than a pronounced idolization of President Roosevelt and a willingness to beat up anyone uttering any kind of anti-Semitic remark. After the war, he made various unsuccessful attempts to promote businesses, often in association with his brothers, selling knick-knacks, cruets, and the like. Finally, he came to Dallas to manage a club one of his sisters had bought, and settled into club ownership and management in that city. By 1962, he was running the Carousel Strip Club on his own account and the Vegas Rock and Roll Club on his sister's. He was still quick-tempered and violent, regarded by many as unduly savage when acting as his own bouncer. His accounts were a mess. He owed income tax a fortune, and his bank was cash in his back pocket or car boot, protected by the pistol he normally carried. He roomed with a man friend named George Senator, though the commission disbelieved the rumours that he was homosexual. They found he had an unfortunate natural lisp and a long-term girlfriend. When the president was murdered, Ruby had been in the Dallas Morning News office discussing his club's advertisements. Those who saw him at the time believed he was devastated by the assassination, and he talked incessantly about closing his clubs for 3 days out of respect. A reporter called Seth Cantor, who knew Ruby, swore that he saw and spoke to him at Parkland Hospital at 1:30. The commission decided that Ruby could not have made it from the Morning News office to Parkland and back to his club, where he was next seen, in the time available, and concluded that Cantor was mistaken. Ruby was a bit of a glad-hander, and after going to a service of mourning for the president that night at the synagogue he usually attended on high days and holy days, he went out and bought kosher sandwiches and soda pop to offer to policemen or journalists, both of whom he cultivated in the interests of his clubs. By midnight, he'd gone into the police headquarters in the company of some journalists and was standing at the back of the room with them when the police brought Oswald out for a press confrontation and photo opportunity they had promised. Ruby was among several people who shouted out a correction when the police chief inaccurately described Oswald as supporting Free Cuba, an anti-Castro organization, rather than Fair Play for Cuba, the pro-Castro organization. After the press conference, he continued to mingle with pressmen and secured an interview with his acquaintance District Attorney Henry Wade for Radio KLIF. Later, he went and socialized at KLIF Studios. Before going to bed, he spent an hour talking sadly about the assassination with one of his strippers and a policeman who was dating her, and then went on to the Times-Herald offices, where he demonstrated an exercise twist board he was marketing. On Saturday, he again spent a lot of time with newsmen. He was beginning to believe that he had the makings of a scoop in the suggestion that a billboard reading Impeach Earl Warren, which he had photographed, together with Bernard Weissman's black-edged sarcastic welcome to President Kennedy, represented an anti-Semitic attempt to associate Jews with the forces that had killed Kennedy. He held the really muddled impression that a combination of communists and the rabidly anti-communist John Birch Society might be responsible. He spent a good deal of time at his sister's flat, and he arranged for $5 to be paid to one of his strippers, who telephoned him in desperation about her financial straits, given that the carousel was closed for the weekend and she would have no pay. He told her to call him back in the morning if she still needed additional cash for her rent. On Sunday morning, she did so, at 10:20. Ruby took his pet dachshund Sheba with him in the car and drove to Western Union, where he cabled $25 to Little Lynn the stripper. Passing police headquarters on the way, he saw a crowd gathering. So when he had cabled his money and taken his receipt, he walked back to the building and entered it by a ramp into the basement to see what was going on. He reached the end of the ramp just as officers were bringing Oswald down in handcuffs for transfer to the county jail. A crowd of press photographers were popping light bulbs at the prisoner. Police Chief Curry had decided to do everything possible to keep the media happy. And so, with television cameras rolling, Jack Ruby burst out from the back of the assembled pressmen and shot Lee Harvey Oswald in the abdomen. The commission concluded this was a spontaneous act, and there was no evidence of any conspiracy whatsoever. No one who loved his dogs as much as Ruby would have left Sheba shut in a car while going to certain arrest. They heard rumours that Ruby was seen with Oswald prior to the murders. They found them unsubstantiated. They heard rumours that he was attached to organised crime. They found this was not believed by law enforcement officers maintaining surveillance on the mafia, and they agreed that Ruby was too small and insignificant an operator to be used for an important hit, and a hit in which his inevitable arrest might lead him to crack under questioning. They could not offer a formal conclusion on his sanity. That might influence his appeal. But they did note that a doctor who examined him declared him to be suffering from depressive psychosis, and they quoted J. Edgar Hoover's observation that this meant he was not sane enough for the results of a lie detector test to have any value. So Ruby, too, was a lone nutter. All this the Warren Commission published, with a host of detail and full identification of its sources. And they examined the history and efficacy of presidential protection and the actions of the Secret Service in Dallas. And they examined Oswald's finances minutely to explain his travels to Russia and Mexico. No stone seemed left unturned. Their report was greeted with unstinting praise from the press. The answers were all there. The case was closed. The doubts had been satisfied. There was no mystery about the assassination. I didn't read the report at the time. I read the press accounts of it, and I was completely satisfied. I knew from other areas of crime history that the simplest explanations are the most probable. The first police prime suspects are usually rightly selected. Conspiracies are almost always exposed quickly and conclusively, since the involvement of a number of people leaves secrecy at the mercy of the flakiest co-conspirator. I knew people were publishing books challenging the findings of the Warren Commission, but such books always appear when there's money in a sensational rewrite of history, and I knew that such rewriting is easy. A massively complex case will always have small points of contradictory detail among the witness accounts, difficult matters of precise timings, or police smoothing out of rough edges, any of which can be built up carefully into an elaborate, complicated, alternative story. Worth nothing. So I paid no attention to the growing assassination industry for 25 years, until in 1989, radio listeners asked me to examine the Kennedy case on my Murder After Midnight programs. And so, at long last, I started reading some of the books which disputed the simple story of the two lone nutters causing the great tragedy. Harold Weisberg had been first off the mark. A professional investigative researcher who once worked for the Senate, he knew his way round government documents, and quickly saw that the 26 volumes of evidence contained much detailed testimony that had not been used in the main report. When the Freedom of Information Act opened the closed files of the FBI and CIA to interested citizens, Weisberg was in the forefront of those starting lawsuits to winkle papers out of the agencies. He's assembled a vast collection of files and documentation on the Kennedy case and is unstintingly generous in sharing it with fellow researchers, whether they agree with him or not. In 1965, he came out with Whitewash, the report on the Warren Report. This did not present a cogent alternative theory of identifiable conspiracy. It was an attack on the Warren Report for failing to pursue leads which argued at length could be made to suggest that Oswald could not have acted alone, might not have acted at all. Over the next 9 years, Weisberg produced another 5 books on the case, reaching the broad general conclusion that the CIA and FBI had been derelict in their duty to protect the president, and the whole Warren Commission was a partisan cover-up to protect the agencies at the expense of truth. Publishers were not interested, except that Dell reprinted the original whitewash. Weisberg is justifiably an angry man. He almost certainly knows more facts about the assassination than anyone else in the world. The FBI certainly thinks so. Yet from a base of immensely less knowledge of the Kennedy case than Weisberg, I have no hesitation in dismissing his conclusions. For he commits the cardinal historical sin of ignoring the clear, broad pattern in favour of nitpicking detail. An example. On Thursday, the 21st of November, 1963, Lee Harvey Oswald stayed with Marina at Irving in the midweek, whereas previously he had only stayed overnight at weekends. He gave a false explanation about collecting curtain rods to Buell Frazier, who gave him a lift. The following morning, Frazier and his sister saw Oswald carrying a long, narrow brown paper parcel when he went to work. After the assassination was reported as having been perpetrated from the book depository, Marina feared that Lee must be involved and went to Ruth Payne's garage to see that his rifle was still there. The blanket it was wrapped in seemed to be untouched, to her relief. When the police visited and picked up the blanket, finding it empty, she was instantly certain Lee had done it. The rifle itself, with Lee's palm print on it, was found hidden in the room where he had been working at the end of the morning. 3 shells fired from it lay close to a box carrying a palm print and fingerprint of Lee's in front of the assassin's window. Nearby lay a homemade brown paper parcel, the right size to have held the rifle. Lee's prints were on the parcel, too. Its paper and sealing tape had come from the book depository. Lee was the only book depository employee to flee the neighbourhood immediately after the assassination and fiercely resisted arrest. Under questioning, he denied having killed the president, but refused to explain his actions and told a number of lies. The broad picture is clear. Oswald premeditatedly went to Irving to collect his gun, took it to the book depository and fired it at Kennedy. Whether alone or on behalf of a conspiracy, is not indicated by the facts given. But Weisberg believes he's proved Lee could not have taken and fired his gun because Buell Frazier and his sister thought the parcel Lee carried was probably a couple of inches too short to hold the disassembled rifle, and they thought Oswald carried it between his hand and armpit, which would have been impossible if the rifle ran straight up his side, because another book depository employee denied that Lee carried any parcel into the building at all, because the man who issued the paper and tape was sure he hadn't given any to Lee, and the tape was always issued wet so that the parcel would have had to be assembled as soon as the materials were issued, because Lee's prints might have got on the rifle and book boxes at any other time, or have been planted by the authorities, Because Weisberg's calculation of the time speed cop Marion Baker took to get into the building suggests that he or the depository's manager, Roy Truly, should have seen Lee descending the stairs, not in the first floor lunchroom where Baker actually saw him. Because any other book depository employee might have had possession of Oswald's gun and the paper parcel and left them where they were found. This last point alone indicates the flimsiness of Weisberg's kind of argument and its thorough inappropriateness in works of history. Weisberg's immediate impact reached little further than those enthusiasts who had been privately collecting cuttings and information about the assassination, and whose amateur sleuthing from their desks and libraries had no influence on public opinion. It fell to Mark Lane to put the question, "Who killed Kennedy?" back in the public domain. Lane, a New York lawyer, had an unenviable position in the Warren Report. He told the commission that he had information that Jack Ruby, Patrolman J.D. Tippett, and Bernard Weissman, promoter of the Welcome to Dallas advertisement, held a long meeting in the Carousel Club on November the 14th, 1963. He refused to name his informant, and when recalled before the commission, declared that he still lacked permission to reveal the source of his information. Lane must have known that such testimony was worthless. As a matter of law, it was hearsay and inadmissible in the courts. As a matter of history, hearsay evidence is perfectly acceptable. But the source of the saying is needed. Sources are absolutely crucial to historians. A subjectively honest party's recollection may be biased by his own interests, so these need to be known and weighed. A short-sighted witness with broken spectacles offers poor testimony to what he has seen. A deaf witness with a defective hearing aid offers poor testimony to what he has heard. Since frivolous and self-aggrandizing liars exist and pop up to muddy the waters of all notorious mysteries, it is absolutely vital to know who Lane's informant was. He has never said. Ruby denied that such a meeting ever took place, or that he ever knew Weissman or Officer Tippett. Weissman denied that such a meeting ever took place, or that he ever knew Officer Tippett or Ruby. Tippett's widow denied that her husband ever went to the Carousel Club and expressed no awareness of his knowing Ruby or Weissman. Carousel Club employees on the premises on November the 14th denied knowing anything about any such meeting. After interviewing all these people, the Warren Commission rightly dismissed Mark Lane and his story as wasting their time. Yet in Rush to Judgment, published in 1966, Lane had an international bestseller and put himself at the forefront of the Commission's critics. Lane had been engaged by Oswald's mother, Marguerite, and hoped to interrogate witnesses before the Commission. He cast himself as Oswald's counsel for the defence, and his historical technique, accordingly, was snippety and selective, like Harold Weisberg's. He sourced all his statements in thorough footnotes, but did not indicate where and when he had carefully extracted only the evidence that suited him and raised reasonable doubt. All this would have been perfectly acceptable in the courtroom, but it was not good history. And outside the pages of his book, in interviews and lectures, Lane was quite reckless in charging officialdom and the agencies with lying and covering up. His sad example pulled out of the woodwork a mass of new bad books based on the hot-headed imaginations of amateur researchers who worried away at problems inherent in the authorised version. Quickly nicknamed the Buffs, to their great indignation, these Kennedy-obsessed non-historians forced new questions onto the agenda, and terms like the grassy knoll and the magic bullet quickly gained international currency. But most publicity of all went to one determined and deluded man whom even the Buffs were forced to renounce. He claimed to have found new evidence. He introduced new names as co-conspiratorial suspects. Some of his suggestions are still widely current. And he was portrayed as a lone heroic figure battling against corrupt officialdom in Oliver Stone's film JFK. step forward District Attorney Jim Garrison, the New Orleans super buff.